one, two, three, testing. I think it should be fine with this one. Maybe I will be showing some stuff with my hands, but it should be fine with this one.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
So I think we could start right now.
No, it's okay. It's good.
Come on.
Welcome everybody. My name is Willem Novák and I will be presenting Blender Cam. How many of you do know what is it actually? I see some hands. Okay, that's great because this is what most people would think when they ask me about what does this thing do. And I post it on the Blender Artist Forum or anywhere, so it's not that. It's computer aided machining in Blender. What is computer aided machining? It's basically if you are wanting to manufacture something, like either it be a table or a sculpture, this is a computer guided machine which mills. Some people, for most 3D artists, 3D printer is a much closer thing to think about because like you don't meet a CNC machine so often. And there are not so many open source machines like in the printing area. So, but basically, for example, this table was done with a CNC machine. These letters have been done with a CNC machine. And when I, for the first time, got a machine like this because I wanted to do wood sculpture, you cannot print wood. So I realized there's not enough open source software to do it in good resolution. Okay, here is a bit information about the CNC machines. There is a simple CNC machine, like a hobby machine. These can be like from a small size up to machines which are as big as a room and cost multi-million euro. And there is like some specifics of these machines. Like it's really an industry standard for manufacturing a lot of stuff, including injection molding stuff, which is like anything from plastic that is manufactured massively, has this process in the beginning, where the mold or the steel part which is injected to has to be manufactured through this process. Okay, and they have 3 to N axis, which means like the one you see here is, oh my God. Sorry, I forgot to connect the computer, but I will go on talking, and while the computer starts again. Okay, so, I was talking about axis in CNC milling, and that is you can have three axes, which means the machine can go just from one side to the material, or you can have more axes, like four, where the thing is turning in it, and five, where like basically the machine can go from any side to it. I'm sorry, like this computer takes a lot of time to start again when it goes to fourth sleep because of the battery. I think that there was I will just remember it was in the presentation. There is one thing that these machines are nowadays replaced with 3D printing process a lot, but still you cannot print wood. And that's also why I am using it, because my main focus is wooden sculpture. I'm sorry, it's still starting. So I will. The next part of the presentation was the CNC process. Actually, how do you achieve a result with? Oh, great, it's back. Okay. These are some videos of this process actually in at works with Blender, where some simple stuff gets manufactured on a hobby CNC machine. Okay, it's not running. Phew. Okay, now it's running. This is like some simple plywood cutting on this machine. Basically, what is the thing, why the plugin is a kind of complex thing, is that it has to compute offsets. So you have a drill that is drilling something, some shape, but you have to go to the side in the case of 2D cutting, and you have to go to up or like to offset the shape of the cutter in the case of 3D cutting. That's why it is using quite complex collision algorithms, and for meshes which have up to several million polygons, it is really heavy computational task. As for example here, where is like a simple 3D sculpture, but it already has several hundred thousand polygons. And that's actually why I started developing this, because there are several open source plugins or softwares to do simple 2D dimensional cutting, but for 3D cutting like this, I couldn't find any software that would actually work, that wouldn't compute a path for such a simple sculpture longer than one day, for example. So that's it, I will. So BlenderCam is an add-on for Blender, but it's not distributed as an add-on. I distribute it as a complete downloadable package where you get Blender with the add-on and some libraries which are needed to run it. That's basically one of the reasons why to distribute it separately. The second reason is so that people have another interface in the beginning when they open it. Most people who are into this manufacturing processes don't understand really animation software so well, and there's no reason for them to see the timeline. So the other stuff which is written here, I've already said. Interesting is that it's quite successful, although if I post about it at Blender Artist, like nobody knows usually what it is or so, but it gets like about 20 downloads a day. Statistically, and I also get donations for it, so it's quite successful and quite moving. Actually, right now, there is a presentation in another room running where a very sympathetic architect is presenting his work, and he did a lot of work with BlenderCam for architectural models or landscape models. Here are some features which I will show very soon in praxis. What is important for me, that you have many strategies to choose, because it is very important to save time and get the best quality in CNC milling. And very often it's really about costs, because every tool you use gets ruined in some time. And and also the machine time is much more expensive than with 3D printers, for example, because there you get very few electricity, and CNC machines eat a lot of electricity and possibly also other material like cooling liquid or these tools, which each tool for CNC milling can cost up to 30 euros, and you can use up this tool during doing one work. Okay, so there are some more features which people who know what is CNC milling will understand why they are good. Like, for example, limiting the operation space, that you can define a curve on which you are and you are operating only inside this curve to, for example, make some precise detail in the work, and that again saves you a lot of time. Here is a bit about the workflow. If you want to try it yourself, you don't have to have the machine yourself. You can just have somebody and know about some fab lab where you can use it, but you still should know this know-how, because usually it takes a lot of time to prepare the tool parts for the machine, so to do it you need to bring the ready tool parts to the machine to have this job done. So you create what you want. You don't need to create it in Blender. It can be Inkscape or any vector art or anything else. You get it into Blender, and then you have to think, like, this is there mainly because, for example, sometimes if you dig too deep, there can be collisions. Again, unlike with 3D printing, there is a spindle spinning, and if that collides with the material or, like, something is not computed well, then that's a big problem. Okay, so you make the tool parts, run the simulations, export the G code. The G code is like basically a program which the CNC machines understand. Each machine has a different G code. Blender can support up to like about 10 types of G code, and many more can be easily added. Okay, and then it's like, watch the machine do your artwork. It sounds simpler than it actually is. I will now show a bit of the workflow with Blender Cam. This is just a little show of why it's not so easy to compute. You see that there is like a certain path, this, and that is the cutter, which is a spinning tool, is following it. Now, when I switch to a rounded cutter, it goes along a different path. So that's basically what's complex about it, that you have to do this many million times per piece to have precise movement. Okay. Now I just prepared a very simple example, because the computations can take time, similar like with rendering, and for some of the reliefs it computes up to half an hour a path. I just did a very simple example where this is already preset, where this is basically a path that the tool follows, and you can see there are I did two operations here. One is for a so-called rough part and the other for finish. Usually you want to use a big cutter to get away all the material, and then a fine cutter to do a very good finished surface. And so the big cutter does most of the job. Okay. Also, if I compute the other path, the finishing path, you can see that for the rough part, I set it so that it's actually above the surface. So there is some material left, and so that for the finishing path, you don't have any, like, because the big cutter can make like some, it could basically go through the surface, the finished surface you want to achieve. So you make it a bit off the surface. Like the price of it, that you can get it faster, means that it's not so precise, because the cutter can vibrate, for example, and that's why you do it this way. Blender Cam has basically a lot of settings that you can find in professional cam softwares, which can cost up to 5,000 euro, for example, or just plugins for some CAD softwares. So just quickly, there is about 10 strategies. Some are marked experimental because they are not finished. And my development model is like to get things first working, like give it to the users and mark them as experimental, because then I can get feedback. Because there are not so many people giving feedback, so it's very useful to have it at least like this enabled. Also, things that are work in progress. So there is lots of parameters which are very good if you would start with it getting serious, like what direction you want to get into the material, because it really does matter how it's cutting. Like there are so-called layers. You can see that, for example, this path goes in layers, because of course it cannot go all the way down at once, because it's so it's going in layers, and you set them according to your cutter and to the power of your machine, if how much can it handle. This is the same with the speed. So there is so-called feed rate, which is the speed with which is going the machine. Very important is, of course, the size and shape of the cutter. Blender Cam is supporting actually any number of cutters, but the basic ones are a flat, a ball, and a V carve, which is for carving, and then it's custom, where you model a mesh of the cutter. It has to be a rotational mesh, of course, and then it computes the offsets according to that. It has some optimizations factors which are very important because some people want to do very precise work, which is quite simple, some CAD work. For that is the so-called exact mode, which uses the bullet collision engine. But then there is, if you switch it off, that is a mode where you can use meshes of up to like anything Blender can handle because it's basically using Z-buffer and it converts everything to image and then computes the offsets. But it's quite essential for working really with high resolution stuff. That is something I want to show you as the next step. Because this is like, I wanted to show some of the work I did. This is a wood bas relief, and that's what I am doing with Blender Cam mostly. Like, I work with wood, and this is like, this piece is like for 50 hours in the machine until it makes it ready. It's pretty detailed stuff, and you couldn't do this with the classical collision. Polygon collision because it would take days to compute. So this is like a Bosch-inspired artwork called Office. It's not hell, but it's called Office. And this is the big battle with the cars. And this is some mass grave. It's quite a dark artwork, but it was some feeling I had about what's going to happen maybe in some years. But, this is the goddess of shopping, actually. Like, you can see the... Yeah, she has six hands, two counters, and two hamsters below her. Like doing the yin yang of shopping. This is the address of Blender Cam. That's also a thing I wanted to show you, just for sure, the website. There is a gallery of artworks that people posted. I tried to show it off. Also, I warned people really strictly, like that the Blender Cam is more for artistic use. I made an aircraft engineer in Warsaw recently who is using it to mill into steel. Oh, I'm not connected. Never mind. And also uses it to manufacture scientific equipment with the software. I met architects who are using it, and that's it. You can download versions for Linux, Mac, and Windows, which are pre-compiled. You can also compile the libraries yourself. It's just two Python libraries, which are not by default in Blender. It's NumPy. In some Blender compilations, it is already. And then it's Polygon. It's for work with polygons, and maybe there will be more, because it's always about optimization, but also about support. For example, now Blender Cam is stuck with Blender 2.69 because the Polygon library is not for Python 3.4 and this kind of issues. But basically, I try to have it so that everyone who wants to start with it can download a working package. That's it. I think it's just time for questions. Are there any? Actually, that's a great question because I'm already working on that, and I actually have the code finished for it. It's just in prototype stage. So, if you look here on the web page, there are some subversion commits, and some of them you can read that I actually coded already 4- and 5-axis support, where there is. I don't know any other open source package that is working with this, but I don't have a machine like this. So that's the question. It's a very responsible job to do this because it can be dangerous, like if people collide. But now a guy who is really giving feedback wrote me he purchased 4th axis for his machine. So we are going to next step with this because I have it 1 year already ready, this 4- and 5-axis operations, but that's the state of it. But it's planned. And it's almost there. Okay.
Is there a support for a rough part and a finished part, or do you only place the finished part and then set the levels as offset to roughly get your rough part?
Yeah, there's no wizard to prepare it or to... You mean some kind of rest milling? Because, of course, you can do... there are layers, and you can do rough and finished part, as I did show, but there is no wizard now which would do it for you. Basically, each operation has the layers enabled by default. That's it by now. So each operation is handled almost like rough part, but you have to switch it. Okay?
Next question.
Here down is here in the first row.
Do you support laser cutters as well? And how do you deal with the material properties in terms of motor speed, which is going to be different for wood or plastic or leather?
By now, there is no library of materials that would set the spindle speed, which is or the speed for laser cutting. Laser cutters are not yet supported because nobody requested it. Like I always try to respond very fast to requests, but they have to be posted somewhere, either into my email or into the forum, which is also on the webpage. It's basically a Google group, and I didn't have access to laser cutter, but soon in 2 weeks my friend is getting one, so that's also a way to get one.
Two questions. One, how much does the CNC machine you are using cost? And second, for example, the sculpture of the goddess, how much did it cost to create it?
Okay, the CNC machine I was doing this with, all of the works you saw, costs 1,600 euro. But it's a hobby machine. It was kind of like the last work I had to do in four parts, than to glue them and bind them together, because it was already bigger. It was like this size. And so this is the cost of the machine without the spindle, for example, and without computer. If you want to do complex, this was like really the furthest you can push such a cheap machine. And it was really, sometimes it was a real pain to work with it, I have to say. So maybe it's better to invest more to get more job done in shorter time. Now we purchased with a friend a bigger machine which has 2.5 meters. So we hope to work to do some nicer work. Yeah, but and the work, like there is like the cost of dried wood, which can be quite expensive, but this piece for it could be, I don't know, 40 euro. And then there would be, for this one, 12 hours running time, but the goddess is not in enough detail. It should be double detail. I know it now. So the last work is in the detail, which is like supposed to be, and it's like 30 hours for it. But the preparation time was much longer because I had to, for example, realize how to shift the work in the small machine. If I would have a bigger one, and also a lot of problems like this, like for example, BlenderCRAM has support for splitting the files because you have many million instructions, and the control software sometimes does not support so many instructions, which happened to me with Mach 3, or I'm not sure, most people probably use Linux CNC or others, so this kind of things I had to overcome. So like the material cost would be like, I don't know, 100 euro, 200, but the time cost would be 10 times more.
Okay, so.
There is another question, but I think we are running out of time.
Very nice.
Okay, I actually have an answer, another question. Regarding the laser cutting question, I think there's a workflow already in Blender that you can use because the Volker De Vries has just finished his patch for Freestar where you can export SVG. So basically you can now just output an SVG file and throw it into your cutter and you're done.
That is true, but are you sure that SVG will have correct measures?
Hey. I can only speak about my laser cutting workflow. I set all the lines to a hairline and. Or I actually don't understand the question probably.
Yeah.
Maybe rephrase it. Or...
Yeah. That's interesting because then you probably use Inkscape has a very good plugin for laser cutting, for example, or you use some software you got with the machine.
We use the driver of the machine. We also have a self-developed driver at our hackerspace now since 1 week or so. It's called Control Cut. I don't know the details, but basically the driver comes with the machine. You just feed it. Just a vector data as hairlines, and that's it.
Great.
Thank you very much. Thank you also for perfect timing.
Yeah. Okay, nice. Thank you for your attention.
Now there is a small change in our schedule, and about 3 p.m. is going to talk Anthony. Okay?
Oh, well, not yet. I forgot to say that.
Okay, so now it's Terry to speak.